All right, so we're gonna talk right now about something that is crucial if you are suffering in low back pain, and that is the importance of having your cluneal nerves evaluated. So the cluneal nerves, the main ones for low back pain is usually the superior cluneal nerves and the middle cluneal nerves. We're gonna put a photo here, Mark, of the superior cluneal nerves and the middle cluneal nerves, and then also where the distribution, AKA where you would feel the pain if those nerves were causing you an issue. So that's all right here. Now that we've got that kind of picture in mind, the biggest thing that I see is a misdiagnosis of entrapment neuropathies and friction neuropathies causing neurogenic inflammation of the superior and the middle cluneal nerves. How could that look like? Well, I mean, it would look like low back pain. Commonly, what I see in clinical practice is that when we have a superior or a middle cluneal neuralgia, basically neurogenic inflammation of these nerves, patients are usually gonna have pain that is not improved with traditional measures. So let's say you go and you have an epidural and it doesn't really help, or you have facet joint injections with cortisone and it doesn't really help, or a sacroiliac joint injection doesn't really help. That's one piece of information. Commonly, if physical therapy is not attuned to these cluneal nerves, then the physical therapy could actually make patients temporarily worse during. And so what I commonly hear is patients tell me that they stopped going to physical therapy because it was making their back pain worse. And part of the reason for that is if physical therapy does not know that these nerves are involved in the patient's pain, then they may be doing certain movements and exercises that actually could be aggravating those nerves. And so that can happen. And as a general rule, when we have neurogenic inflammation like this, we can see that activity actually makes pain worse, and it doesn't get better with more activity. So commonly what we see with like a tendinosis, so like if we talk about the rotator cuff, or even if we have, you know, a little bit of osteoarthritis in the low back, it generally hurts with some movement, but then once you get moving, things kind of loosen up and things feel better. But what we've found with neurogenic inflammation is that doesn't really let up. And so continuous exercise doesn't really give patients the relief that it would in other situations. In terms of movements, one of the big things is that you can have pain with what's called flexion, which is bending forward, and also extension, which is leaning back. And part of the reason that you can have pain with both of these movements is the way that these nerves are set up. So these nerves have to come off of the spinal cord, and then they have to travel through different pathways, through muscles, in between muscles, sometimes through what's called a fibro-osseous tunnel, in order to reach the skin. That means that along those paths, you can have different points where there could be compression or friction. And so what we see is that when you bend forward, the space between the outer part of the nerve, basically in the butt, and the spinal cord, that distance increases. And so you can actually have a lengthening of the nerve, which is normal, but if that nerve is inflamed, then you can actually end up with more pain because that stretch on the nerve that's already inflamed causes more inflammation and more pain. And then when we go into extension, or basically arching the back and kind of looking upwards, you can have compression of the muscles because the muscles of the low back need to flex and contract in order to do that movement. What happens is that flexion and contraction of those muscles can actually pinch on nerves as the nerves are either passing in between two muscles or actually through one of the muscles. That compression can therefore cause additional pain, which can therefore result in you not being able to do those movements. Now, with the superior and the middle cluneal neuralgias, we don't always see that it's both. We don't always see both with flexion and extension causing pain, but we commonly see that, and usually we're seeing it obviously with at least one of those, either flexion or extension. Now, in terms of diagnosis, the number one way to diagnosis is with a physical exam, okay? If someone comes to me and, you know, in a comment on social or whatever, and they say, oh, I have low back pain that gets worse when I bend forward, what is it? I don't know. I have to do a physical exam because there's like 7 or 8 different things that could be contributing to those pain. And there's actually way, way, way more. But most of those things are big, scary things that are ruled out, you know, just knowing that the patient's in good health. But the physical exam is needed in order to really determine what structures are contributing to pain. Yes, imaging can be helpful, and you've heard me talk about this before. Yes, imaging can be helpful, but imaging is not gonna show us a cluneal neuropathy. It's not gonna show us that your superior cluneal nerve is inflamed and firing off extra discharges because it's inflamed, and that is what is sending signals to your brain saying, pain, do something about this. That's not gonna show up. And so we have to get our hands on patients to do physical exam maneuvers, to palpate, to move them into positions, to test things in order to really understand what might be going on with their pain. So that is crucial, crucial. There are many different treatment options out there for, cluneal neuropathy, cluneal neuralgia, nerve pain, neurogenic inflammation in general, things varying from physical therapy, myofascial work, chiropractic work, surgery, injections, building the foundations, lymphatic drains. There's so many different options out there that could help you, and I encourage you to explore all those different options because you need to find what's going to resonate with you. What I'm going to talk about now is what resonates with me and how I approach this, the cluneal neuropathy and cluneal neuralgia. Essentially, what we do is if we confirm with our physical exam that that's what is contributing to pain, one of two things that I generally do. The first is perineural injection therapy. This is subcutaneous injections, usually of just 5% dextrose that we buffer with a base in order so that it's not acidic. And we do these subcutaneous injections along the distribution of the nerve. Now, this can be really beneficial for mild cases where we just have just generalized neurogenic inflammation where we don't have a single or even multiple entrapments of that nerve or fascial restrictions around that nerve or friction injuries around that nerve. So generally our more milder cases, I'm leaning more towards the less invasive perineural injection therapy. When we start thinking that, okay, you know, that I think there's actually an entrapment here, right? We have a fascial adhesion or the neurogenic inflammation is so bad that the nerve has swollen a little bit. And so the canal that the nerve generally passes through is now tighter because that nerve has swollen. That's when I'm going to opt at looking at doing a nerve hydrodissection under ultrasound guidance. So what we do there is we find the nerve under ultrasound. So here's our nerve. We advance our needle to the nerve, and then we inject our fluid around the nerve. Okay, that's going to do two things. One, we're going to do a non-surgical decompression of that nerve. We're actually going to create space around this nerve so that the nerve is not being as compressed by the tissues around it. And two, depending on which solution we use, we're actually going to create some healing and calm down some of that inflammation in the nerve. Things like 5% dextrose can be beneficial for that. PRP or other platelet products such as platelet poor plasma or platelet lysate can be really beneficial like that. In some of our more extreme cases, we can look at doing allogeneic growth factors such as placental matrix product or even autologous stem cell therapy from bone marrow or adipose tissue. And I personally have found that our approach with adipose tissue works better than our bone marrow concentrate for this nerve hydrodissection. So that's generally how I approach these things. But again, the first and foremost thing you need to do is you need to get an evaluation to see what is causing your low back pain and if the cluneal nerves are involved in your pain pattern. So if you're working with a doc and you're struggling with low back pain and they've never talked to you about it, ask them about the cluneal nerves. If they dismiss you and it seems like they don't know what's going on, maybe they're open to looking into it and working with you on that. Some docs are super, super awesome at that. If not, maybe it is time to find a new doctor who actually includes an evaluation for the cluneal nerves in their evaluation for low back pain. All right, everyone, see you later.